Melissa, now here's a ballet that's really changed quite a bit over the years. And the most obvious point of change, I think, you tell me if I'm wrong, but is that the costumes are completely different today from the ones you wore.
Yes, I remember when Korinska coming to a rehearsal, and he was very excitedly speaking to her. And then when I went to the fitting, I had a tutu on. You know, it had a fringe, black fringe, and the boys were in mustard-colored tights. And the girls wear multicolored, muted earth colors, in a sense. And theirs were costumes where the tutus looked longer than mine. Mine was kind of perky. Mm-hmm. And theirs was a longish type tutu.
Whereas today...
And today, well, when he revived the ballet when we got to the New York State Theater, and it became a completely different ballet, visually, because the costumes were completely changed. It had a kind of upper body was like a peasant costume. It had puff sleeves and a basque. You know, the bodice was very high, squared off in the waist, and very lovely chiffon-y type tutu. I mean, skirts. About three or four layers of probably silk organza, which hit above the calf. The choreography was missed. You only saw skirts billowing, and all the intricate choreography was hidden under the skirt. To me, it was a completely different ballet. It's lost some of its humor, in a sense. It was very aristocratic as we entered. And we did half the ballet as a classical pas de deux, and then when it was over, it was as though the ballet had finished. But then it started up again. And somehow the costumes made it work even better, because the music was very dramatic, and one didn't know whether it was funny or not, whether one should smile at this. But it was much more impressive that it had a tongue-in-cheek value to the whole bit. And then what sets it off as far as humor is that you have a little girl coming out in center stage doing her own thing and then excusing herself for it and then getting back into line. And I think that sets up the humor of the rest of the ballet. I think when he first did it, he was very much influenced by Bournonville, and he had spent a number of months there.
In Denmark.
He wasn't with us for a while, and he returned. And he came up with this ballet, but not as a Bournonville-type ballet, though the choreography was in, had been watching class, and he was influenced by what he had been seeing. It became more Bournonville that you can accept it as Bournonville when he changed those costumes. When I performed it, I think both Jacques and I realized when we were dancing it, we did the movement as though it had big music, big movement, big and strong to this little tiny sound. And I think that made a success of it. Mr. Balanchine knew that Jacques would always add that little bit of danger or excitement, even though no change in choreography, because for instance, I would be in one place doing a double pirouette and I had to be caught by this partner, but he was over there, way over, and he would dash up and catch me at the last moment.
Which makes it look like a cliffhanger.
God, yes. Absolutely. And that's, I think, Mr. Balanchine depended on Jacques to do that.
Sure.
And
I think we noticed in the pas de deux, the step you're talking about, and then there's this very much off-balance promenade.
Yes.
I mean, Balanchine has used off-balance, really, from the 20s.
Of course. If you're dancing on balance, you're square, and there's no excitement. And actually, Mr. Balanchine believes that the beginning of a movement is not there. It has a beginning off-balance to get there and then to go somewhere else to something else. If you're not trained or worked with Mr. Balanchine and you are setting a ballet on a group of dancers from another company with a different background of training, it's very difficult for them to understand how you get into that position, how you get into a pique arabesque. And once I was doing something and he said, you know, when you do pique, why don't you go from the back of your foot, that's your little toe, go to the middle, and then so it would have to be like off to get there. He said, you know, you should work like that to try to do it. No, I don't know if he said that to anybody else. So you don't go right on like that. This is so exciting when he would say something like this.
I know.
When Mr. Balanchine would give a class, for instance. He gave special classes at the beginning when we joined, when I joined the company. There were only a few people in the class.
The ballerinas.
The ballerinas. And there was nothing, actually, in a very subtle way, he said there was nothing I was doing right, correctly. No, because you see, he would explain how you do a plie, grand plie. You can do 1, 2, 3, 4, up 2, 3, 4, or you can do 1, 2, and up 2, or 1 and up. But the way I was trained, you go 1, 2, 3, 4, and stop off at the floor and then come up again, you know. So in a sense, that part of my training was still with me very much. So even though I had danced with ballet theater for about 3 years, but that was very acceptable there. The one thing about Balanchine, a plie is a preparation. It's not really a step. So you have other people being taught that a plie is to go into the movement. And Mr. Balanchine, you have to see it. Mr. Balanchine passes through it. So there's different timing of plie. Plie and up, or plie and go. You know, the timing, that makes the difference in his choreography, the preparations. And then he doesn't want the audience to see those preparations. I was taught to go up and be coming down. He wanted very specifically, as soon as you plie to come off, you already did the enchaussées. Terribly important. Do you know, I tried doing this in this session we had. I had never done enchaussées like that. He must have seen the expression on my face. And he was, again, his humor. He said, you know, you should practice it like this every day. And maybe in 10 years, you'll be able to do it. But you know, if you don't try, even in 10 years, you won't do it. But I said, 10 years, you know, to myself. But you know, it made such a point for me that I did practice it that way. Well, in 6 months, just that one step, just getting the feeling of the jump and beating like that, I could do glissade, whatever he wanted me to do, get off the floor. In 6 months, I learned all the vocabulary the way he saw it.
Let's talk a little bit about your variation. The coaching and what makes it difficult, what makes it what it is.
It's actually 1 minute.
You've timed it.
I've timed it. Those are 60 seconds and there are 60 movements. It's nonstop. You have to condition yourself to dance it because within the choreography and the phrasing, the direction of the movements are different. I mean, it's not that you're just going at a pace like this.
Sure,
you are now getting nuances.
Yeah.
You are grabbing the music and holding it back, and then you catch up. I mean, there are places where you do that. And then the plie releve again. The first step that he set this for me, and I looked at the clock and I said, oh, that just took an hour. 1 hour he did this. And he was having such a good time doing it. So the variation has a good time feeling, bubbly. And then I came back to rehearse again after about 2 weeks. We came back, he asked me to come in, and now the timing of the variation, he suggested, not say change, maybe if you would do the accent in, it would be better. He wanted to override, in a sense, the movement, go over the music, and that was very good. I think he liked me for that. I always felt
you would go with him.
I go with him.
Take
if he wants. Oh, yes. Yeah. And then I felt, God, I could do that. I'm on top of the music, not on the music or in the music. I'm on top of it.
Let's talk about the rest of the ballet. What are some of the other difficulties?
Well, I would say, you know, there are certain tricky partnering movements. There's a moment where you do a fouetté in arabesque, and the partner allows you to go off balance, so off balance, but then within a very short time, he has to pull you back on balance. And so it's a matter of timing between a man, the partner, and you. Not everybody does it right immediately. And girls are afraid, because I've set this ballet on other dancers, and they're afraid to let themselves go. It's such a great feeling, because you do the movement fouetté, you fall, and then your boy's pulling you back again on your leg. Well, that's great. You don't have to do anything. You just have to hold your position.
You mentioned that Balanchine, when he partnered, you said that he was a wonderful partner and so on, but one of the things that was so terrific was that he could get down really, really low.
Oh, yes, and nobody does that anymore, because It had to do with presenting the dancer.
Right.
You know, everything. He was such a divine partner. He revered women. He really did. And his pas de deux is the best. I've danced so many of his pas de deux that in partnering, in the way he would do it, he would exaggerate that partnering from a theatrical point of view. And so much of that is lost. And in Donizetti, there's one moment where he wanted Jacques to go to go really down, and well, it would look very awkward if you didn't feel you could do it, or you'd look
this
more
would
like.
This would be an arabesque. Mechanism.
I'd be an arabesque and
punch low,
and
low,
the,
low,
and the man is really low, promenading in front of you, not promenading you, but showing that you can stay on point. And you don't, you know, and he's moving to the other side of your body and then turns you around. He was really a ham, in a sense. If you're going to do something, you have to do it in such a theatrical way that the audience can't even realize how what you're doing. It could be simple, but he wants it to look difficult so that they would, you know, be excited by it.